So here we have the truth table of the full adder, and we're going to look at it using a different perspective. And this new perspective is actually the first step that allows us to design faster adders. So what we're going to do now is we're going to re-express the carry out and sum in terms of something called generate propagate logic. At first, the observations about generate propagate logic are going to seem really fundamental and like groundbreaking, but then we will discover that it doesn't really change anything. It's just a way to restate the inputs, A and B, that's all. And it doesn't change either the delay or how the delay behaves as the bus width increases. So it might seem like a redundant thing to do until we delve a little bit deeper and start to discover new and wonderful things about generate propagate logic. So first, let's just discuss what generate propagate logic is. So up until this column, this is just the truth table for the full adder, and we've seen it before. So it's just a truth table of two functions, carry out and sum, and there's nothing really weird happening to the left of this line. But to the right of this line, we have three new bits. And they are G for generate, D for delete, and P for propagate. And G, D, and P are mutually exclusive bits, meaning if you look at them, you will find that in any row, only one of these three can be a one at a time. So either G can be one, D can be one, or P can be one, but never can there be two who are one at the same time. And so what do they represent? They represent the state of the carryout. So if you look at the carryout in the last two rows of the truth table, carryout is equal to one. Compare it to carry-in. Carryout is equal to one when carry-in is zero and when carry-in is one. This means that for these two last rows, the full adder is generating a carryout, meaning that it's producing a carryout regardless of the value of carry-in. Carry-in is could be zero, could be one, and it will still be producing a one at carry out. And so we say that the full adder is generating, and we assert the generate bit, and the two other bits are zero. For the first two rows of the truth table, carry out is zero, even though carry in could be a zero or a one. So we say that the full adder is deleting rather than generating, and therefore we assert the D bit. For the four intermediate rows, we find that carryout copies the value of carry-in. So it's exactly the same as carry-in. And so we say that the full adder is propagating the value of carry-in to carryout. And so all we have done is we have observed that the truth table, the eight lines of the truth table, are divided into chunks. There's a chunk containing two rows in which the carryout is being generated, meaning that its value is one, regardless of carry-in. There's a chunk where the carryout is null, regardless of the value of carry-in. And there's a huge chunk in the middle, half of the truth table, where the value of carryout is exactly the value of carry-in. And so we encode the state of carryout using these three bits, generate, delete, and propagate. So what's good about this? What's interesting about this? What's good and interesting about this is that G, D, and P can be defined exclusively in terms of A and B. So recall that in the n-bit adder, A and B are ready at the start of operation. So they are ready at time equal to zero. G, D, and P can be calculated in terms of A and B. And therefore, we can also say that G, D, and P are ready at the start of operation. Because if A and B are ready at the start of operation, then so are G, D, and P. But how are G, D, and P determined in terms of A and B? If you look at the two rows where the truth table is generating, you will find that what is distinctive about them in terms of A and B is that both A and B are equal to 1. So we can, with confidence, say that G is equal to AB. And if you look at the middle four rows of the truth table where propagate p is equal to 1, you will find that what's distinctive about them is that only one of a and b is equal to 1, which is the exclusive OR, and therefore we can say with confidence that p is equal to a exclusive OR b. When you look at D, you will find that what is distinctive about it is that both A and B are null, and therefore D is, with confidence, A bar times B bar. Now, we can also determine the values of S and C out in terms of GP and D, but unfortunately, we also have to use carry in together with GP and D in order to calculate S and C out. And that is something that you should have been able to conclude, because GP and D contain only information about A and B. And whether it's S or C out, both need C in order to calculate. But perhaps the expressions for S and C out are gonna be more helpful. So let's look at that. P is equal to A XOR B, but S was A XOR B XOR CN. And so S is simply P XOR CN. Because if you expand P, it's going to be A XOR B XOR CN. And so you can calculate S in terms of P and CN. C out is a little bit more interesting, because the carry out is going to be 1 when the full adder is generating, so G, or when it's propagating the carry in P CN. So C out is going to be true if either of these two things happen, if you are generating or if you are propagating the carry in, and the carry in is 1. It's interesting, there's one thing here. If you expand G and P, they will give you the same expression that you had for carry out in the previous video. But the interesting thing here is that D does not make an appearance. So we can calculate C out without having to write a value of without even having to write D. And this makes sense, because D is simply the absence of either P or G. There's no case where D is equal to 1 and either G or P are equal to 1. So D happens exclusively when G and P are both equal to 0. And so when G and P are both equal to 0, C out is going to be 0, which means that if we add D to the equation, it's just redundant, because yes, when G and P are 0, the carryout will be deleted, and that goes without saying. So how is implementing an n-bit adder using a propagate-generate logic going to improve our lives? Or is it? I mean, it's a fair question to ask if it even is going to improve our lives. What's going to happen is that A's and B's, A0, B0 through A4, B4, are first going to pass through something called a setup stage. And this setup stage is going to calculate the G's and the P's from the A's and the B's. And it's going to calculate them according to these two equations. So this is just an AND gate and an XOR gate. And notice that all these setups are happening in parallel at the same time, because all the A's and B's are ready at the same time. So the delay of the adder is going to have a certain T generate propagate at the beginning, just as an overhead, a setup overhead in these setup gates. It's only going to be added once, because they all happen simultaneously. Then when everything is ready, we have to calculate C0 based on this equation. So C0 is going to be G0 plus P0 Cn. And then we can start calculating C1. So we have to wait until this is ready before this starts to calculate. And we have to wait until this is ready before C2 starts to calculate, and so forth. And so in fact, we're going to need n minus 1 t carry, just as in the ripple carry adder. And the last thing to be ready will be S4, and so plus one final T sum. So in fact, the delay is exactly the same as the ripple carry adder, because this is a ripple carry adder. There's nothing different about it. Restating A and B in terms of G and P does nothing special. It just adds a small initial setup time, but even that is immaterial. So we have done nothing really because the architecture of the adder is still the same. It's a repo carry adder. But if we look at it internally, perhaps we'll see that we have done a little bit. It's not that we have done nothing. We have done a little bit to help things. So this is how it looks from the inside. And this is an architecture called the Manchester carry chain. You can see that as implemented above, the Manchester carry chain is going to give you a delay identical to the repo carry adder. So obviously, each of these is the carry path of a full adder. So each of these blocks is a carry path of one of the full adders. And we are completely ignoring the sum path because sum is important, but it only matters once, because it makes an appearance only once in the delay equation. So what we should be focusing on is optimizing the carry path. This is what matters the most. So if you look at one of these gates, because they are repeated, so understanding one of them helps us understand the others. This is obviously a dynamic gate. So we have a clock here and a clocked PMOS. This clocked PMOS is gonna pre-charge this node, C naught bar, to VDD when the clock is zero. And then when the clock is one, G naught is either going to be one or it's going to be zero. If G naught is equal to one, then it's going to discharge this node down to zero. So if it discharges this node down to zero, then the output of this inverter is going to be one, regardless of anything else that happens. And that is what we want. We want carry out to be equal to 1 when G is equal to 1. And so if G is equal to 1, it's going to discharge this node regardless of anything else, and it's going to assert the carry out regardless of anything else. But if G is equal to 0, we still want carry out to take the value of carry in if propagate is equal to 1. So if propagate is equal to 1, this pass transistor is going to work, and it's going to short C in to C out bar, allowing us to get C out as C in bar. Now, if neither P nor G are equal to 1, then the output node is going to preserve its pre-charge value of VDD, and C out is going to be equal to 0, regardless of anything else, which is the delete case. So this is called the Manchester carry chain. As it is drawn here, it's going to have a delay behavior similar to the ripple carry adder because it is a ripple carry adder. But when we look at look ahead addition, we can actually use the Manchester carry chain to do some interesting things.